Hi, I'm Albert, and I'm making the Ice Climber game for the Nintendo Entertainment System from scratch. Welcome to my Devlog. Before we dive into this third episode, I want to quickly thank all of you for your support. Your likes and shares mean a lot. This episode will be brief as I'm currently on vacation, but I have still found time to work on this exciting project. If you are on vacation too, I hope you are making the most of it and getting some well-deserved rest. Over the past 2 weeks, I have made significant progress and I'm pleased to share that I have reached approximately 60% completion of the project. While it may seem like there is still a lot of work to be done, the truth is that most of the core features have already been implemented. Among the most important features I have completed, I want to highlight the ones that are the core of the game. I have integrated physics formulas to realistically simulate the jumps and falls of the protagonist. This doesn't just add a touch of realism to the game, it also significantly enhances the gameplay experience. Managing and rendering sprites and animations is fundamental in a platformer like Ice Climber. At this point, all the objects that make up a mountain, including enemies and the protagonist Popo, are functioning correctly. This includes not just their visual appearance, but also their real-time animations. Another crucial aspect of a platformer is handling collisions. Here is an example of the number of collisions that occur within a brief moment during the gameplay. Detecting collisions isn't a simple task, and it requires the use of efficient algorithms to ensure the game runs smoothly. In future episodes, I will delve deeper into this topic. I have completed the implementation of the objects that form the structure of the mountains. These include decorative objects like the side walls, which don't affect the gameplay directly, but contribute to the visual atmosphere. Terrain objects such as bricks that represent surfaces of grass, dirt or ice, defining where Popo can walk. Special objects like clouds, conveyor belts, and indestructible objects that add dynamism and challenge to the game. If you are enjoying this video, don't forget to like, subscribe and hit the notification bell, so you don't miss any updates on this project. In this episode, I want to emphasize one of the most important aspects of game development, the state design pattern, widely used in game development. The state pattern is essentially the use of finite state machines to control the states and transitions between the states of an object. In this remake of the Ice Climber, every object implements a state machine, which is especially useful for managing the states and transitions of Popo and the game enemies. Here, I'm showing you the state machine diagram for Popo. Despite the apparent simplicity of the game, the protagonist can have many different states. For example, there are states for when Popo is walking, jumping, falling, or even sleeping on ice. These transitions are managed by functions called triggers, which allow switching from one state to another. It's important to note that a state change is only possible if the current state allows transitioning to the desired new state. For instance, Popo's state machine doesn't allow the player to jump while sleeping on a surface or when falling. That's it for this episode. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to like, subscribe and hit the notification bell. Thank you for joining me on this journey and I will see you in the next episode.